I welcome you all to today's lecture on marriage and matrimonial rights in Muslim law. In order to understand the nature and essentials of marriage, one should know the essentials of marriage and its effects. In this lesson, we will discuss forms of marriage, that is legal requirements, classification of marriage, legal effects of valid marriage, enforcement of conditions of marriage, and restitution of conjugal rights. The legal requirements of a Muslim marriage are proposal, that is ijab, acceptance, that is qubool, guardianship, that is wilayat, representation, that is wakalat, and witness, that is gawahi. Ijab, that is proposal. The intended marriage between two persons should first be proposed by or on behalf of either party thereto. This is called ijab. Qubool, that is acceptance. The proposal so made should be accepted by or on behalf of the other party to the intended marriage. This is called qubool. Form of ijab and qubool. The expressions conveying ijab or qubool must be reasonably certain so as to result into a completed transaction. They must not convey a mere intention or promise to marry. Wilayat, that is guardianship. As regards those who are not competent to contract their own marriage, ijab or qubool, as the case may be, is to be made by their marriage guardians, that is wali. In Shafi and Ismaili laws of marriage, guardian is also to act on behalf of a girl who has attained puberty, unless it is not her first marriage. In Hanafi law, a woman who has attained puberty can act, if she so desires, through a marriage guardian. Wakalat, that is representation. Those who are competent to contract their own marriage can make ijab or qubool either personally or through a representative. Gawahi, that is witness. Witnesses needed for a marriage are two males or one male and two females. Under Hanafi, Shafi and Ismaili laws, ijab and qubool should be made in the presence and hearing of witness, who must be Muslim and competent to contract their own marriage. Absence of witnesses will render the marriage irregular. Under Isna Ashari law, presence of witnesses is not legally required at the time of marriage. Majlis-e-Wahid, that is single sitting. Proposal and acceptance are to be made in a single sitting, signifying continuity of transaction. Proposal, when followed by acceptance, results into a marriage contract. The above-mentioned requirements are essential for a Muslim marriage. No other formality is necessary. It is a wrong notion to believe that there are any specific ceremonies of a Muslim marriage. Marriage feast or any other rites or rituals on the occasion of marriage are merely customary. It has nothing to do with the legal validity of marriage. The Delhi High Court in one case decided the validity of conversion of religious faith of the parties to the marriage. In Fahim Ahmed versus Navia Lakshmi, the twin problem before the court was whether there was a valid conversion. The court laid down that, even assuming that there was a valid conversion of the respondent, the putative marriage lacked all essential requirements for a valid marriage under Muslim law, like offer, acceptance, two male witnesses, and free consent, etc. The Nikahnama itself did not indicate a requisite marriage. It is a testimony for a fact which had not been proved in the instant case. Therefore, the High Court held there was no valid marriage subsisting between the litigants. Classification of marriage. Islamic law provides certain legal requirements for the solemnization of marriage. Also, marriage with certain persons is allowed and with some others it is disallowed. On the basis of the fulfillment of these requirements, marriage under Muslim law have been classified into three classes. Number one, valid, that is sahih. Number two, void, that is batil. Number third, irregular, that is fasid. We will consider each class with legal effects. Valid marriage. A marriage which conforms in all with the law is termed as sahih, that is correct. For a marriage to be valid, it is necessary that there should be no prohibitions affecting the parties. Now, prohibitions may be perpetual or temporary. If the prohibition is perpetual, the marriage is void. If it is temporary, the marriage is irregular. void marriages. A void marriage which has no legal results is termed batil or void. A marriage forbidden by the rules of blood relationship, affinity or fosterage and some other prohibited marriages are void. The issue of a void marriage is illegitimate. A void marriage being unlawful produces no mutual rights and obligations between parties. The illegality of such unions commences from the date when the contracts are entered into and the marriage is considered as totally non-existing in fact as well as in law. Irregular marriage. A marriage is irregular when there is no permanent bar to a marriage. A union between a man and a woman may be either lawful or unlawful. Unlawfulness may be either absolute or relative. If the unlawfulness is absolute, the marriage is void. If it is relative, we have an irregular marriage. The following marriages have been considered irregular: a marriage without witness, a marriage with a woman undergoing iddat, a marriage contrary to the rules of unlawful conjunction, a marriage with a fifth wife. The Isna Ansari and the Ismaili schools of law do not recognize this distinction between void and irregular marriages. They treat a marriage either valid or void. Effects of an irregular union. It is very essential to learn the effects of irregular marriage on the relationship of the couple. This can be explained as: in an irregular marriage, either party may terminate the union at any time. Neither divorce nor intervention of a court is necessary. One of them may say, "I have relinquished you," and the irregular marriage ends. If there has been consummation in an irregular marriage, the wife is entitled to dower, proper or specified, whichever is less, and she must observe iddat for 3 courses. No rights of inheritance are created between the husband and the wife by an irregular marriage. The issues are treated as legitimate and are entitled to a share of the inheritance. The legal effects of a valid marriage. The effects of a valid marriage can be explained as under. As soon as the legal contract is established, consequences flow from it as provided by the Muslim law. It legalizes the enjoyment of either of the spouses with the other in the manner which is permitted by the law. It also subjects the wife to the power of restraint of husband, as well as she becomes entitled to certain rights and privileges. It renders her dower and maintenance obligatory on the husband. A valid marriage establishes on both sides the prohibitions of affinity and the rights of inheritance and the obligation of justness between the wives. On the wife, it imposes submission to the husband and confers on the husband the power of correction when she is disobedient. It renders unlawful the conjunction of 2 sisters and those who fall under the same category. The effects of a valid marriage may be summarized as: the sexual intercourse becomes lawful, the children born of the union are legitimate, the wife becomes entitled to dower, the wife becomes entitled to maintenance, the husband becomes entitled to restrain the wife's movement in a reasonable manner. Mutual rights of inheritance are established. The prohibitions on the basis of affinity comes into operation. Observation of iddat becomes necessary if the marriage is dissolved by death or divorce. Any agreement between the spouses becomes enforceable so far as they are not inconsistent with the provisions and policy of law. Individual existence of the spouses remains unaffected. Restitution of conjugal rights. We know that the most important obligation arising out of a marriage is consortium, which not only means living together, but implies a union of fortunes. A fundamental principle of matrimonial law is that one spouse is entitled to the society and comfort of the other. Thus, while a wife without lawful cause refuses to live with her husband, the husband is entitled to sue for restitution of conjugal rights. And similarly, the wife has the right to demand the fulfillment by the husband of his marital duties. The right, however, is not absolute. The Holy Quran enjoins husbands to retain their wives with kindness or to part with them with an equal consideration. The court may grant restitution subject to certain specific conditions. where a husband claims restitution of conjugal rights against the wife who has withdrawn from the former society. Some of the valid defenses are available to the latter. Existence of a lawful marriage between the parties to a suit for restitution of conjugal rights is a condition precedent to the grant of desired relief. So, where it is proved that their marriage is void, the remedy cannot be granted. Also, the remedy cannot be granted in case of irregular marriage, even if it has not been consummated, where the husband has not paid the prompt dower of the wife, while the marriage is yet to consummate. He cannot ask for decree of restitution. In Reno versus Hiralal, the court observed that a decree of restitution of conjugal right is a proof of unreasonable withdrawal by a spouse. Thus, in such cases where a husband secures a decree of restitution of conjugal rights against the wife's petition filed subsequent to the grant of the decree will meet with failure. However, the Kerala High Court in Haziz Pasha versus Gulzar Bano held that an ex parte decree of restitution of conjugal rights obtained by the husband is not a bar to the consideration of petition of maintenance filed by the wife under section 125 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Cruelty is a defense against restitution. Where a husband who has treated the wife with cruelty afterwards claims restitution of conjugal rights against her while she has withdrawn from his company, the court may not oblige him. As regards the test of cruelty in the case of Munshi Bazlur Rahim versus Shamsu Nisa Begum, the Privy Council held, there could be no special concept of a Muslim cruelty, and in the case of a Muslim too, as in all other cases, the test of cruelty should be based on universal and humanitarian standards. This ruling has guided various Indian courts, which have in different cases regarded the following as instances of cruelty on the part of the husband: actual violence of such a character as to endanger personal health and safety of the wife, reasonable apprehension of such violence, misconduct, gross failure to comply with the conditions in marriage contract or clear breach of such a condition, unfounded accusation of adultery, blasphemy, keeping a mistress, and bigamy. Lastly, it may be made clear that in law, a Muslim wife too can get her conjugal rights enforced by means of a decree of restitution. In Sheikh Abdullah versus Hussain Ara Parveen, High Court of Bombay was called upon to clear the doubts relating to restitution of conjugal rights. The court laid down that two queries must be answered in deciding this controversy, namely, whether there existed a valid marriage in accordance with the Muslim law between appellant and respondent, and whether respondent had withdrawn from the society of the petitioner without reasonable cause. The court laid down that in order to succeed in a petition for restitution of conjugal rights, it was obligatory upon the appellant to prove the existence of a valid marriage between him and the respondent. The court in the above cases tried to decide the issues under the orbit of Islamic law in its true spirit, including the conversion from one faith to another, which indeed should be taken into consideration after having analyzed all the situations of pre and post status of the parties who have been converted. The conversion should not be only for the purpose of the marriage. With these words, I thank you and conclude the lecture.